Good evening. So, as I reminded you all in the morning also, we are back to discussing some of the later papers. And today we are going to do CAT 2018 ka first slot ka paper, jismein se we will start off with VARC. So, we did half of the verbal and RC in the morning. We did 17 questions out of 34. And now we are going to continue with the remaining half, right? So, guys, before we get into that, as I always say, you should know whom you're listening to and why. Right? So, great. I'm Munira Lokhandwala and I am Calcutta alumna, a serial 100 percentiler in CAT and a 99 percentiler in GMAT. I also have a CAT verbal book published by Wiley and available on Amazon. You can find me on the Unacademy YouTube Crack CAT channel. You can also find me on the Unacademy app, guys. So, Unacademy app, aapko milega Play Store mein. Go to the Google Play Store and search for Unacademy Learning app. Usko download kijiye, install kijiye. And within that, you have to go for the plus CAT courses, correct? So CAT will be your goal and plus courses is what you will go for. We have close to 100, 200 educators in just CAT. And these educators teach in all languages, guys. So whatever language you are comfortable with, you can learn within that language. You can learn from a particular teacher. You can watch the videos as many times as you want. You can decide on your timing, right? So there's complete freedom. ये CAT का preparation आप completely अपने मर्जी से चला सकते हैं, correct? So that I mean what can be great, couple that with the fact कि जो आपके course fees है, they are very very less compared to any of the other players in the market. So you get immense freedom, immense benefits with negligible cost, right? So you should go ahead and subscribe. कौन सा subscription लेना चाहिए? That we can discuss towards the end of the session, right? You can use my code MUNIRA10 to get a great discount. So I will see you now with the puzzle. I give you all a puzzle as usual, right, in the afternoon. I hope you all have given this some thought. You have a telephone company that places round cables in round ducts. Okay. So, ye hai cable. Cable ka fixed hai diameter. Correct? Cable's diameter is 2. So, iska diameter hai 2 cm. You have to find out ke jo duct hoga, uska diameter kya hona chahiye. And not just for 2 cables in a duct, but what if there are 3 cables, what if there are 4 cables. So, let us do 2 cables here. Correct? 2 cables are very easy to do, guys. So, yahan pe pura jo diameter hai, that is equal to twice the diameter of the cable. Duct ka jo diameter hai, usme do duct, do cable baith rahe hai na. So duct ka jo diameter hai, wo cable ke diameter ka double hai. So cable ka diameter hai 2, so duct ka diameter hoga 4 cm. This was peaceful, right? So yahan pe answer hoga, for 2 cables, the answer will be 4 cm. Now, what happens when you have 3 cables? So, you'll have to see it like this. Correct? Now, the whole duct, right, can be broken up into 3 cables. These 3 cables inside make an equilateral triangle of side 2 cm, the diameter. Correct? 2 cm ka side. Now, this also is the diameter, this is the radius of the cable. So, ye ho gaya 1 cm. Correct? This is nothing but the height of the equilateral triangle. And now we need to find this part. So let us find the height first. The height of the equilateral triangle. Correct? Height of the equilateral triangle is going to be root 3 by 2 into the side. And the side itself is 2, so it is going to be root 3. Correct? So this part is 1 centimeter, this part is root 3. What about this part? So if you extend this, you'll form another triangle, equilateral triangle coming down. Right? This is going to be 60, this is going to be 60. So you're going to make another equilateral triangle. So yahan pe wapas aa jayega aapko root 3. So your entire diameter is going to be 2 root 3 plus 1. Right? Finally, ye fourth wala. Let's do this on the next page. So if I now draw this here, diameter hoga iska radius first, so ye ho gaya 1. Then it will be the diagonal of this square. And then again it will be the radius, which is 1. So it will be 1 plus 1 plus diagonal of the square. So square ka side kya hai? Side of the square is 2. So what is the diagonal going to be? Diagonal is going to be 2 root 2. Hence, yaha aapka diameter will be 2 plus 2 root 2. That's your answer. Right? So great guys, now we'll continue with some verbal. Here is the fourth passage. We did three passages in the morning out of 5. So the CAT 2018, right, had 34 questions, out of which 5 passages in RC accounted for 24 questions. And then there were 10 questions of verbal. So we did 2 verbal questions in the morning along with 15 RC questions. So today we'll do the remaining 8 verbal questions, right, with the remaining 9 RC questions. Great. So let's start off with the fourth passage. When researchers at Emory University in Atlanta trained mice to fear the smell of almonds by pairing it with electric shocks. That's sad, right? They found to their consternation means something that they couldn't understand, something incomprehensible, that both the children and grandchildren of these mice were spontaneously afraid of the same smell. So when they trained chuho ko to fear this smell, then wo chuhe ke bacche aur grandchildren were spontaneously afraid of the same smell. This is not supposed to happen. Generations of school children have been taught that the inheritance of acquired characteristics is impossible. Okay, you cannot inherit acquired characteristics by parents. Ye aap inherit nahi kar sakte. Aisa sikhaya gaya tha. A mouse should not be born with something its parents have learned during their lifetimes. That is the meaning of acquired. Okay, maine apne lifetime pe sikha. It is not something that I was born with. Any more than a mouse that loses its tail in an accident should give birth to tailless mice. So if someone has, right, you lose some part of your body in an accident, doesn't mean your kids are born without that body part, right? Kids are born healthy. So as they are physically born healthy, they should be mentally also born in a similar healthy way. Modern evolutionary biology dates back to a synthesis that emerged around the 1940s and 60s, which married Charles Darwin's mechanism of natural selection with Gregor Mendel's discoveries of how genes are inherited. So modern evolutionary biology, jo abhi bhi hum use kar rahe hai, wo shuru hua 1940s-60s mein, when it synthesized, when it merged, brought together. Okay, Charles Darwin ka selection and Gregor Mendel ka how genes are inherited. The traditional and still dominant view is that adaptations from the human brain to the peacock's tail are fully and satisfactorily explained by natural selection and subsequent inheritance. The natural selection, guys, you need to remember that's Darwin. Yet, new evidence from genomics, epigenetics, and developmental biology indicates that evolution is more complex than we once assumed. तो ये नेचुरल सिलेक्शन से पूरी तरह से यू कैन नॉट सेटिस्फैक्टरीली एक्सप्लेन. इन हिज बुक ऑन ह्यूमन नेचर द एवोल्यूशनरी बायोलॉजिस्ट एडवर्ड ओ विल्सन क्लेम दैट ह्यूमन कल्चर इज हेल्ड ऑन अ जेनेटिक लीश. ओके, सो जो ह्यूमन कल्चर है वो एक पूरा लीश इज वॉट यू नो वेन यू हैव टेक डॉग्स आउट फॉर अ वॉक राइट. The strap that's around their neck, that's called a leash. So, human culture is held on a leash. यानी वो कहीं ज़्यादा दूर नहीं जा सकता. Whenever you, the leash का मतलब क्या है, right? कि आप थोड़ा आगे पीछे जा सकते हो, but you cannot go too much out. The metaphor, right, needs revision. Imagine a dog walker struggling to retain control of a brawny mastiff. This mastiff is the human culture. Okay, so the dog walker, which is our genes, is trying to control the human culture. The pair's trajectory. Kiska kaun pair? Ek to dog aur ek dog walker. Ye pair ka jo path hai reflects the outcome of the struggle. Now imagine the same dog walker struggling with multiple dogs on leashes of varied lengths, with each dog tugging in different directions. Okay, so the same dog walker is struggling with multiple dogs, right? And now uska kahin pe bhi ja sakta hai. All these tugs, so ye kaun se dogs hai? Ye dogs are basically the influence of developmental factors, including epigenetics, antibodies, and hormones passed on by parents, as well as the ecological legacies and culture they bequeath. तो इकोलॉजिकल मतलब अराउंड नेचर, सराउंडिंग द नेचर. सो व्हाटएवर वी आर गिवन फ्रॉम देम एज वेल एज हॉर्मोन्स, एंटीबॉडीज, ये सब का टग से मिला के करेक्ट अपना एवोल्यूशन आगे बढ़ता है. तो ग्रेट. नेक्स्ट, द रिसीव्ड विजडम इज दैट पेरेंटल एक्सपीरियंसेस कांट अफेक्ट द कैरेक्टर्स ऑफ देयर ऑफस्प्रिंग. तो ये नॉर्मली हम समझते हैं, रिसीव्ड विजडम मीन्स के नॉर्मल व्हाट वी हैव रिसीव्ड एज नॉलेज, कि नॉर्मली पेरेंटल पेरेंट्स के साथ जो एक्सपीरियंस होता है वो ऑफस्प्रिंग यानी बच्चों के कैरेक्टर्स को इफेक्ट नहीं करते, एक्सेप्ट दे डू. सो नाउ हियर इज द कॉन्ट्राडिक्शन, कि पेरेंट्स के एक्सपीरियंस कैन अफेक्ट बच्चों के कैरेक्टर्स. द वे दैट जीन्स आर एक्सप्रेस टू प्रोड्यूस एन ऑर्गेनिजम्स फिनोटाइप, द एक्चुअल कैरेक्टरिस्टिक इट एंड्स अप विद इज अफेक्टेड बाय केमिकल्स दैट अटैच टू देम. सो जीन्स जो होते हैं करेक्ट, They change their actual characteristics based on chemicals attached to them. आप इतना ही समझे, phenotype ये सब भूल जाए. This is not important. Everything from diet to air pollution to parental behavior can influence the addition or removal of these chemical marks. So ये जो chemicals हैं वो छोटी छोटी चीजों से भी change हो जाते हैं, which can switch genes on or off. Usually these so-called epigenetic attachments are removed during the production of sperm and egg cell. But it turns out that some escape the resetting process. तो ये जो changes होते हैं correct, जब sperm और eggs का production होता है right in the beginning, तो ये काफी सारे changes are reset and they are back to normal. But some are passed on. Turns out that some escape the resetting and they are passed on. This is known as epigenetic inheritance. ये normal inheritance नहीं है. And more studies are confirming कि ये सच में होता है. So let's return to the almond fearing mice. The inheritance of an epigenetic mark transmitted in the sperm is what led the mice's offspring to acquire an inherited fear. तो ये पास हो गया बच्चों को right in some markers. Epigenetics is only part of the story. Through culture and society, humans and other animals. Animals inherit knowledge and skills acquired by their parents. So parents ka kafi yogdan hai, correct? Because of society, we inherit knowledge and skills acquired by our parents. All this complexity points to an evolutionary process in which genomes, over hundreds to thousands of generations, right? Epigenetic modifications and inherited cultural factors over several, perhaps tens or hundreds of generations, and parental effects, which is over single generated time spans, right? So, pehle thousands, genomes is thousands, hundreds to thousands. फिर यू आया टेंस और हंड्रेड्स एंड देन सिंगल जेनरेशन टाइम स्पैन्स कलेक्टिवली इन्फॉर्म हाउ ऑर्गेनिजम्स अडैप्ट. These extra genetic kinds of inheritance give organisms the flexibility to make rapid adjustments to environmental challenges, dragging genetic change in their wake, much like a rowdy pack of dogs. So, ये जो सारे छोटे-छोटे चीजें हैं, they give flexibility so that we people can make rapid adjustments to changes in environment. और फिर वो genetic भी वैसा ही change होता है, right? So great. Now let's look at questions. The Emory University experiment with mice points to the inheritance of. So what do we inherit, guys? We inherit acquired things, first of all, not psychological things, not personality things, right? We inherit what the parents acquired. So it can be acquired characteristics or it can be acquired fears. Yahan pe example diya hai fear ka, but it is generally for characteristics. So best is option 2. If you go and check also, guys, yahan pe dikhaya inheritance of acquired characteristics is impossible, but that is not true, right? So it is acquired characteristics, that's the answer. Option 2. Which of the following best describes the author's argument? What is the author saying? The author is saying ki pehle modern evolutionary bana jo Darwin aur Mendel ko synthesize kiya. And then Wilson ka ek book hai, correct, which is on human nature. So together best explain evolution. No, evolution mein epigenetic hai, lot of things are there, right? And nowhere else do they say ki something is doing a good job of explaining and something is not. Right? The author ka khud ka, you know, we don't understand what the author ka mat hai iske baare mein. So ye option is out. Is unfairly underestimated. So again, Mendel ka theory fair hai, unfair hai, kuch bataya nahi gaya hai. This is out. Wilson's is sub-scientifically superior. Again out. Which is better? Nothing is mentioned. But 4 is best. Look at how mild it is. Theory of natural selection puri tarike se explain nahi karta. You have to add culture, you have to add epigenetic, you have to add a lot of things. So 4 is best because it is so mild, it has to be true. Right? Next, which of the following, if found to be true, would negate the main message of the passage? So what is the passage saying? Okay, besides natural selection, right, you have a lot of other factors. More importantly, acquired characteristics. So mujhe negate karna hai, so I have to say ki ye jo natural selection hai, that plays a larger role. And these other characteristics do not play such a large role. So a study affirming the influence of socio-cultural markers. Anything that says natural selection ka kam kaam hai doesn't help. So one is out. A study highlighting the criticality of epigenetic inheritance to evolution. In fact, ye to strengthen karega. So two is out. A study indicating the primacy of ecological impact on human adaptation. Primacy, matlab ye sabse primary hai, ecological impact. Which means ke acquired ka badh jayega. Because ecology is around us, right? So ye 3 is also out. Best is 4, jo natural selection or inheritance ka baat karta hai, right? So if this is true, then other things will play, right? And they're saying sole influence, aur ko influence hai hi nahi. So ye se main message definitely gets negative. The passage uses the metaphor of a dog walker. To argue that evolutionary adaptation is most comprehensively understood as being determined by what? Okay, so what is it determined by? If you just go back here and check. With multiple dogs, developmental factors, right? Epigenetics, antibodies, and ecological legacies. Ye sab hai. So ek to genomic kuch nahi hai. Genetic hai, genomic nahi hai. So I can eliminate option first and option second. Then extra genetic nahi hai, epigenetic hai. Correct? So option 3 also can be eliminated. best is option 4. Great, guys. Let us look at the next passage. Oops. Yeah. So this is a part of the next passage. The Indian government has announced an international competition to design a national war memorial in New Delhi to honor all of the Indian soldiers who served in the various wars and counter-insurgency campaigns from 1947 onwards. So, international competition rakha hai, where you are actually going to design a national war memorial, right, to honor soldiers from 1947. Jab se India ka independence hua hai, tab se jo bhi soldiers ne war kiye hai, right, who have fought for the country, unke liye ek memorial. The terms of the competition also specify that the new structure would be built adjacent to the India Gate. India Gate is a memorial to the Indian soldiers who died in the First World War. The First World War का मेमोरियल होगा, इंडिपेंडेंस के बाद वालों का मेमोरियल हो गया, किसका मेमोरियल नहीं होगा? सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर, विच वाज बिफोर द इंडिपेंडेंस. सो बिटवीन द ओल्ड इंपेरियलिस्ट मेमोरियल, मतलब जो ब्रिटिशर्स बना के गए, एंड द प्रपोज्ड नेशनलिस्ट वन, इंडियाज कंट्रीब्यूशन टू द सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर इज एयर ब्रश्ड, मतलब उसको थोड़ा झाट के भूल रहे हैं हम, आउट ऑफ एग्जिस्टेंस, राइट. द इंडियन गवर्नमेंट्स कॉन्सेप्शन ऑफ द वॉर मेमोरियल was not merely absent-minded. ये जानबूझ के कोई यानी ये भूला नहीं है कोई. Rather, it accurately reflected the fact that both academic history and popular memory have yet to come to terms with India's Second World War. तो ये accurately ये बता रहा है कि जो अभी का popular memory है, जो history है, academic history, ये अभी तक इंडिया के सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर को अपने टर्म्स पे समझ नहीं पाए. एंड सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर कंटिन्यूज टू बी सीन एज लिटिल मोर देन मूड म्यूजिक, मतलब जब फिल्म में कोई म्यूजिक होता है टुवर्ड्स द मेन इवेंट, राइट. इट इज नॉट द मेन इवेंट इटसेल्फ, इट इज लाइक अ प्रिल्यूड, अ प्रीकर्सर टू द मेन इवेंट, करेक्ट. इन द ड्रामा ऑफ इंडियाज एडवांस टुवर्ड्स इंडिपेंडेंस एंड पार्टीशन इन 1947. Further, the political trajectory of the post-war subcontinent has militated against popular remembrance of the war. So, jahan politically hum jaise gaye hain, right, we are actually trying to avoid making Second World War popular. With partition and onset of the India-Pakistan rivalry, both of the new nations needed fresh stories for legitimizing their own selves instead of focusing on shared wartime experiences. सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर में बोथ इवन इंडिया एंड पाकिस्तान वॉज एज वन कंट्री, राइट, तभी सोल्जर्स गए थे. बट दे डोंट वॉन्ट टू लुक एट दिस शेयर्ड एक्सपीरियंस, दे वॉन्ट टू लुक एट लेजिटिमाइजिंग देयर ओन सेल्फ आफ्टर इंडिपेंडेंस. हाउएवर, द सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर प्लेड अ क्रूशियल रोल इन बोथ द इंडिपेंडेंस एंड पार्टीशन ऑफ इंडिया. द इंडियन आर्मी रिक्रूटेड, ट्रेन्ड एंड डिप्लॉयड सम 2.5 million मेन, ऑलमोस्ट 90,000 ऑफ विच वर किल्ड and many more injured. Okay, so the high million men, 25 lakh people we sent, out of which less close to a lakh were killed, right? Even at that time, it was recognized ki bahut bada volunteer force hai, 25 lakhs ka, right? India's material and financial contribution to the war was equally significant. So not just with people, humne materially, cheezon ke saath aur financially, paison ke saath hi madad ki hai. India emerged as a major military, industrial and logistical base for allied operations in Southeast Asia and the Middle East. Right? So allies, when you had the British and even the Americans joining in, they were called the allies. They came in together, right? This led the US to take considerable interest in the country's future and ensured that this was no longer the preserve of only the British government. So that is, itna India was important, right, ke US started taking interest in India's future. Other wartime developments pointed in the direction of India's independence. In a stunning reversal of its long-standing financial relationship with Britain, India finished the war as one of the largest creditors to the imperial power. Now, Britain owed us money. If we are a creditor, that means people owe you money. So, ye reversal ho gaya. Pehle we used to owe Britain money. Now, Britain owed us money. Such extraordinary mobilization for war was achieved at great human cost. तो इसमें तकलीफें भी हुई हमें, करेक्ट? With the Bengal famine, the most extreme manifestation of widespread wartime deprivation, the cost on India's home front must be counted in millions of lives. तो बहुत सारे लोगों को तकलीफ हुई. Indians signed up to serve on the war and home fronts for a variety of reasons. Many were convinced that their contribution would open the doors to India's freedom. So people went to fight the war because they thought that this would open the doors to India's freedom. The political and social churn triggered by the war was evident in the massive waves of popular protest and unrest that washed over rural and urban India in the aftermath of the conflict. The war, say, right, there was massive protest ki nahi chahiye Britishers. This turmoil was crucial in persuading the Attlee government to rid itself of the incumbents of ruling India. Ruling India was no longer a pleasant thing, it was very unpleasant, that's why incumbents. Incubus. 70 years on, it is time that India engaged with the complex legacies of the Second World War. Bringing the war into the ambit of the new national memorial would be fitting, if not overdue, recognition that this was India's war. Right, so if you get this war also apne national memorial mein, so there would be some recognition that is long overdue, and it is fitting also that ye India ka bhi war tha, Second World War. So this mostly talks about the important role India played during the Second World War and how that helped in getting independence. So let's look at questions. In the first paragraph, the author laments the fact. What does the author feel sad about? Lament is when you feel sad about something, right? So what does the author feel sad about? That there is no recognition, right? Ki Second World War ko log bhool gaye hain. Ye, the author is not sad ki wo India gate ke paas kyun ban rahe hain, right? India lost thousands of human lives, that is true, and it would make anybody sad, but the author's contention was ki iska koi memorial nahi bana. So 3 is also out. Funds will be wasted on another war memorial when we already... So again, this may be true, but that's not the author's point. The author is saying, ki Second World War ko ignore mat karo. So the answer, best answer is option 1. Right? Next. The phrase mood music. So humne kya bola ki mood music matlab hai? Koi shuruaat, it's a prelude, prologue jaisa hai, correct? So setting the stage for the emergence of the India-Pakistan rivalry, not the Second World War. Ye to Britishers ne independence ke waqt kiya, right? A tragic period in terms of loss of lives and national wealth. Loss of lives hua, but we ended up with British owing us money. So national wealth ka loss kitna hua, that is not clear. So 2 can be eliminated. A backdrop to the subsequent independence and partition. This is very good. Backdrop means कि ये पीछे चल रहा है. It's just mood music भी अगर आप देखते हो, तो background में चलता है. So in that sense, a backdrop is very good. A part of the narrative on the ill effects, no. So best here is option 3. The author lists all of the following as outcomes of the Second World War, except. तो क्या क्या आउटकम्स हुए फर्स्ट वर्ल्ड के, कि इंडिया को इंडिपेंडेंस मिला, पार्टीशन हुआ, तो ये है आउटकम. यूएस स्टार्टेड रिकॉग्नाइजिंग इंडिया एज अ स्ट्रेटेजिक लोकेशन, ये भी है आउटकम. बंगाल फैमिन में डेथ्स हुए, ये भी आउटकम है, वी कैन चेक दिस ईयर, राइट? यहाँ पे बंगाल फैमिन के बारे में बोला है, करेक्ट? सो दिस इज ऑल्सो एन आउटकम. लार्ज फाइनेंशियल डेट ब्रिटेन ओव टू इंडिया, नॉट इंडिया ओव टू ब्रिटेन. तो ये जो उल्टा कर दिया ना इंडिया ब्रिटेन के बीच, ये नहीं बताया गया. सो दिस इज योर आंसर, फोर्थ ऑप्शन. नेक्स्ट 25th, 26th, राइट? द ऑथर क्लेम्स दैट ओमिटिंग मेंशन ऑफ इंडिया इंडियंस हु सर्व्ड इन द सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर फ्रॉम द न्यू नेशनल वॉर मेमोरियल is not fitting with the popular view. That's what, right? If you just check here. Between the India's contribution was not, rather it accurately reflected ki academic history or popular memory mein ye abhi tak baitha nahi hai. Correct. So it is academic and popular, which is there in our first option. So we'll keep it. Omitting is appropriate. The author doesn't think it's appropriate at all. He laments ki kyun ne include kiya hai. A reflection of misplaced priorities. No, priorities are not misplaced, right? So 3 is out. Something which can be rectified. No, the author doesn't think can be rectified in the future. So best here is option 1. The author suggests that a main reason why India has not so far acknowledged its role in the Second World War is that it has focused on building its own image politically. Correct? So ye bhi bataya gaya hai. Political trajectory. Oops. Yeah. It blames the war. No, there is no blaming the war. You're correct for the partition. It wants to forget the human and finance. Nobody wants to forget. Yeah, absent-minded. Has been focused on building. This is very good. Use the war as a predominantly allied effort, but India playing aisa kuch nahi. Unka alag hi apne country ka ek political trajectory. Right? So answer here is option 3. Great. Let's look at para jungles. Impartiality and objectivity are fiendishly difficult concepts that can cause all sorts of injustices even if transparently implemented. It encourages us into bubbles of people we know and like while blinding us to different perspectives, but the deeper problem of transparency lies in the words and much more. Twitter's website says that tweets you're likely to care about most will show up first in your timeline, based on accounts you interact with most, tweets you engage with, and much more. We're only told some of the basic principles and we can't see the algorithm making itself making it hard for citizens to analyze the system sensibly or fairly or be convinced of its own impartiality and objectivity. So it's a little difficult. One is a general statement of impartiality or objectivity. This algorithm, this Twitter, this is 2, 3, or 4 are related to Twitter. And one is a general statement. So, yeah, one will come in the beginning or one will come at the end. What is important is when I say it encourages us, what can it be? Yahan pe to koi it nahi hai, yahan pe basic principle hai. Correct? It can only be Twitter's website ka statement. So, there is a very clear 3-2 link. Correct? And deeper problem of transparency lies. So we are only told to some of the basic principles. So this transparency, this problem is transparency. So this 3-4 ka link. Now 3-4, ke baad, I can't talk about impartiality and objectivity. I have given an example, then I will talk about it. No. First I will give a general case, then I will give an example. Dungi. So answer has to be 1, 3, 2 and 4. Right? Great. Let's move on to the next one. This is odd one out. Translators are like bumblebees. Though long since scientifically disproved, this factoid is still routinely trotted out. Matlab wapis show ke liye wapis batate hain. Similar pronouncements about the impossibility of translation have dogged practitioners since Leonardo Bruni days. Inter blah blah blah, published in 1424. Bees, unaware of these deliberations, have continued to flit from flower to flower and translators continue to translate. Though in 1934, the French entomologist pronounced the flight of the bumblebee to be aerodynamically impossible. Okay, so translators are like bumblebees. Why are they? Because it is not supposed to be possible. So 1 or 5 related hai, 5 or 3 related hai, ki similar pronouncements about impossibility have been made about translation. Par translation to ho raha hai, jaise bumblebee ul raha hai. So 1, 5, 3, 4 in some sense are connected. Odd one out is 2. There it's regularly trotted out ka matlab kya hai? Agar ye disproved hai, to ek do baar baatein hongi, why would it be regularly trot out, right? So wo ye sabse alag hai. So odd one out is second option. 29. The four sentences labeled 1, 2, 3, and 4 given in this question, when properly sequenced, form a coherent paragraph. So ye para jumbles hai. So, woodland's canopy receives most of the sunlight that falls on the trees. Swifts do not confine themselves to woodlands but hunt wherever there are insects in the air. With their streamlined bodies, swifts are agile flyers, ideally adapted to twisting and turning through the air as they chase flying insects, the creatures that form their staple diet. Hundreds of thousands of insects fly in the sunshine, up above the canopy, some falling prey to swifts and swallows. So, ये जो है सनशाइन करेक्ट यहां पे भी सनशाइन है सो क्लियरली 1 और 4 का लिंक है फिर यहां पे यू फॉल प्रे टू स्विफ्ट तो यहां पे स्विफ्ट इज इंट्रोड्यूस के व्हाट डज अ स्विफ्ट डू इट ईट्स इंसेक्ट्स एंड देन फाइनली यू से कि सर वुडलैंड में नहीं खाता बिकॉज 1 इज अबाउट द वुडलैंड 4 इज अबाउट द वुडलैंड 3 is about the woodland, but bahar bhi jahan pe bhi insects hai, swifts urte hai. So answer is 1, 4, 3 and 2. Right? Great. Next question. Summary. Ye toh bahut hi bhayanak summary tha. Look at the words. Okay. Production and legitimation of scientific knowledge can be approached from a number of perspectives. To study knowledge production from the sociology of professional perspective, would mean a focus on the institutionalization of a body of knowledge. Okay, the knowledge production, agar aap sociology se dekhoge, you have to institutionalize, make it very corporate, right? The body of knowledge. The professions approach informed earlier research on managerial occupation, business schools and management knowledge. Okay, so pehle wo research ko occupation, business schools, management knowledge mein inform karta tha. It however tends to refile. Matlab thoda usko institutional power structure ko un log importance dete hain in its understanding of the links between knowledge and authority. Knowledge production is restricted to select members of the professional community, most notably to university faculties and professional colleges. Power is understood as a negative mechanism which prevents the non-professional actors from offering their ideas and information as legitimate knowledge. So knowledge sirf kuch hi log cheez produce kar sakte hai, power is looked at as negative. So iska main summary kya hai? Ke ye institutionalize karta hai body knowledge ko, body of knowledge. Correct? So let's look at options. Professions approach aims at the institutionalization of knowledge, but restricts ye to gaap bola hai clearly. So one is looking good. The study of knowledge production can be done through many perspectives, can be approached from a number of perspectives, and that too it's not production, it is legitimation also, so it's missing a lot of parts out here, so 2 is out. Professions approach focuses on the creation of institutions of higher education, okay, focuses on the creation of institutions of higher education, and but that's not the main point. मेन पॉइंट के इंस्टीट्यूशनलाइज करता है और पावर स्ट्रक्चर कैसे है उसको सो 3 इज आउट प्रोफेशंस अप्रोच हैज बीन वन ऑफ द मोस्ट रिलाइड अपॉन पर्सपेक्टिव ये रिलाइंग तो कहीं बताया नहीं गया है सो आंसर इज द फर्स्ट ऑप्शन राइट नेक्स्ट द पैसेज गिवन बिलो इज फॉलोड बाय 4 समरीज अगेन समरी क्वेश्चन Artificial embryo twinning is a relatively low-tech way to make clones. The low-tech way to make clones. As the name suggests, this technique mimics, right? The natural process that creates identical twins. In nature, twins form very early in development when the embryo splits in two. Twinning happens in the first day. So, ye bhi very early hai. while the embryo is made of just a small number of unspecialized cells. Each half of the embryo continues dividing on its own, ultimately developing into separate, complete individuals. Since they develop from the same fertilized egg, the resulting individuals are genetically identical. So, artificial twinning is very much like natural twinning, and it is a low-tech way. So, artificial is low-tech and mimetic, so mimics. So, ye to bola hi hai. Right? So, this is mentioned. Is low-tech, unlike the natural development. तो ये बोलते हैं कि आर्टिफिशियल लो टेक है, नेचुरल डेवलपमेंट हाई टेक है. ये तो नहीं है ना, नेचुरल डेवलपमेंट इज वेरी इजी, इट्स नेचुरल. इज जस्ट लाइक देन वेयर ड्यूरिंग फर्टिलाइजेशन ट्विन्स आर फॉर्म. नो, नेचुरल डेवलपमेंट में, फर्टिलाइजेशन में ट्विन्स नहीं बनते, एक्सीडेंटली बनते हैं. तो 3 इज ऑल्सो रॉन्ग. आर्टिफिशियल इज लो टेक एंड इज क्लोज टू द नेचुरल डेवलपमेंट वेयर द एम्ब्रायो स्प्लिट्स इनटू टू आइडेंटिकल ट्विन्स. पर ये क्लोज नहीं है, ये मोर और लेस इक्वल है, करेक्ट. सो बेस्ट आंसर इज ऑप्शन 1, which talks about equality. Next summary. The conceptualization of landscape as a geometric object first occurred in Europe and is historically referred to the European conceptualization of the organism, particularly the human body, as a geometric object with parts having a rational, three-dimensional organization and integration. The European idea of landscape appeared before the science of landscape emerged. तो पहले जैसे body का भी conceptualization of geometry, right, happened in Europe, वैसे landscape का भी geometric object happened in Europe. And that happened before science came in. It is no coincidence that Renaissance artists such as Leonardo da Vinci, who studied the structure of the human body, also facilitated an understanding of the structure of landscape. Landscape, which had been a subordinate background to religious or historical narratives, became an independent genre or subject of art by the end of 16th century or the beginning of the 17th century. So, pehle wo piche background mein rehta tha landscape, but later on it became an independent genre. It came in the foreground a little bit. Correct? So, landscape became a major subject of art at the turn. No, it did not. It became by the end of 16th century. So, ye to galat hai. Turn means ki jab wo 15 se 16 hota hai, usko bolte hai turn. So, ye to galat hai. The three-dimensional understanding of the organism in Europe led to a similar approach towards the understanding of landscape. One led to the other, we can't say. Right? Which came first, which came second, we cannot say. So, two is out. As an independent genre was aided by the Renaissance artists. Yeah, ye to clear nahi bola hai. Who studied, facilitated. So, three is looking good. The Renaissance artists were responsible. No, they were not. We don't know who was responsible. This is extreme. So, answer is option 3. Right, next one. You have to make a jumble paragraph out of this. Democracy and high levels of inequality. Right? Democracy and high levels of inequality of the kind that have come are simply incompatible. So that's statement 2. Now we have another group, the unwitting enablers. Enablers means they help, but they don't know what they're doing. Unwitting means they don't know what they're doing. Believing these people are working for a better world, they're actually at most chipping away at the margins, making slight course corrections, ensuring the system goes on as it is uninterrupted. Ye hai unwitting enabler. So 1-3 ka clear clue hai. Kinko pata nahi hai ye kya kar rahe hain. They are believing ke they are working for a better world, but they are not doing that. So 1-3 ka clear link. Very rich people will always use money to maintain their political and economic power. Or there is another group, so it is 4-1-3. And this has to be the beginning, that democracy and high levels of inequality do not go together. So it is 2-4-1-3. That is the best arrangement here. Right? Great. 34th. last question of the verbal section. Then we'll do some bonus RC questions. 5 sentences are given and you have to find out the one that is odd. In many cases, time inconsistency is what prevents our going from intention to action. But for people to continuously postpone getting their children immunized, they would need to be constantly fooled by themselves. In the specific case of immunization, however, it is hard to believe that time inconsistency by itself would be sufficient to make people permanently postpone the decision if they were truly cognizant of its benefits. So, ye 3 or 2 ka relationship hai ki time consistency is not the inconsistency is not the only thing. People constantly need to fool themselves. In most cases, even a small amount of immunization was large enough to discourage most people. Not only do they have to think that they prefer to spend time going to the camp next month rather than today, they also have to believe that they will indeed go next month. So this is how we are trying to fool ourselves. So 3 to 5 ka link. And 1 can be a good introduction. Cost jo bataya hai, small cost 4 mein, wo kahi aur nahi bataya hai. So this is the 4th one. Is odd because of the small cost. Right? Great, let's look at some RC. In a recent court case, a copy shop owner was accused of violating copyright law when, in the preparation of course packs, materials photocopied from books and journals and packaged as readings for a particularly university courses, he copied materials without obtaining permission from or paying sufficient fees to the publishers. As the owner of 5 small copy shops serving several educational institutions in the area, he argued, as have others in the photocopy business, that the current process for obtaining permissions is time consuming, cumbersome and expensive. So, a copy shop owner, jo Xerox shop owner ke upar case thopa gaya ki aap copyright ko violate kar rahe ho by taking Xerox copies of materials without asking for permission. So, he says ki it is difficult to obtain permissions from publishers. It is time consuming and expensive. He also maintained that course packs, which are ubiquitous, means they are everywhere in higher education, allow professors to assign important readings and books and journals, too costly for students to be expected to purchase individually. Okay, so individually, bacha ye nahi khareed sakta, aur professors ya important reading karke de dete hain. While the use of copyrighted material for teaching purposes is typically protected by certain provisions, to aap padhane ke liye use kar sakte ho. This case was unique in that the copying was done by a copy shop and at a profit. This is padhane ke liye nahi, it was used to make profit. Copyright law outlines several factors involved in determining whether the use of copyrighted material is protected, including whether it is for commercial or non-profit purposes. Okay, so copyright law sare kafi sare factors bolta hai. Correct, ke wo commercial purpose ke liye use ho raha hai, ke non-profit purposes ke liye, right? नेचर क्या है कॉपीराइटेड वर्क का, लेंथ इम्पोर्टेंस क्या है, जो हमने एक्सेप्ट लिया है छोटा सा अगर, तो उसका कुछ इतना इम्पोर्टेंस नहीं है, करेक्ट? एंड द इफेक्ट ऑफ इट्स यूज ऑन द वर्क्स पोटेंशियल मार्केट वैल्यू. ओके, तो ये अगर हम कॉपीराइट करते हैं तो उसका मार्केट वैल्यू कम तो नहीं हो रहा है. इन ब्रिंगिंग सूट, राइट, इन एक्चुअली मेकिंग अ केस, द पब्लिशर्स हेल्ड दैट अदर कॉपी शॉप ओनर्स वुड सीज पेइंग परमिशन फीस, causing the potential value of the copyrighted works of scholarship to diminish. Nonetheless, the court decided that this reasoning did not demonstrate that course packs would have a sufficiently adverse effect on the current or potential market for copyrighted works or on the value of it. So, publishers bol rahe ki aap aisa zarax karoge to hamara permission jo baki sab log fees deke permission lete hain hamara wo thoda value kam ho jayega. Par court ko lagta nahi hai ki there is sufficient adverse effect here. The court instead ruled that since the copies were for educational purposes, the fact that the copy shop owner had profited from making the course packs did not prevent him from receiving production under the law. So since ye padhane ke liye hi course pack use ho raha hai, to usko law ke andar protection milega. Court bola the owner had not exploited copyrighted material because uska fee is just based on the number of copies, not in what he copies. Right? So not based on the content, right? Charged by the page regardless of whether the content was copyrighted. In the court's view, the business of producing and selling course packs is more properly seen as the exploitation of professional copying technologies, and as a result of the inability of academic panics to reproduce printed materials efficiently, not the exploitation of these copyrighted materials. Right? So, ye court's view mein, this business of producing and selling is a problem on academics. The court held that copyright laws do not prohibit professors and students who may make copies for themselves from using the photo reproduction services in order to obtain those same copies at lesser cost. So, if I can make more cost for myself, then I can obtain the same copies at lesser cost from one of the copy shops. Yeah. So, great. Let's look at questions. Which one of the following most accurately states the main point of the passage? Oops. Yeah. Let me just erase this. So what is the main point? Ke ek case hua for on a Xerox copy owner. Ke aapne ye sab profit ke liye banaya, and then finally the case was rejected. So a court recently ruled that a copy shop that makes course packs does not illegally exploit copyrighted materials, but rather it legally exploits the efficiency of professional photocopying technology. This is good. This is how it ended last week. Agar lesser cost mein ho raha hai, toh why would now students not use it? Right? A court recently ruled are protected by copyright law because the price is based solely. No, they didn't say that they are protected by copyright law, not the course packs. So B is out. A court recently ruled that the determining factors governing the copyrights of material are how the material is to be used, the nature of the material itself, and the length. Nahi, ye sab copyright law mein already hai. Ye court ne kuch iska ruling nahi kiya hai. It is a part of copyright law. So this is also out. Right? As of right now, only A is looking good. A recent court ruling limits the rights of publishers to seek suit against copy shops. It is not limiting the right of publishers. It is just given this one particular reading. So D is wrong. Exceptions to copyright law are made when copyrighted material is used for educational purposes. And no party makes a substantial profit. So substantial ka matlab nahi bata, sirf profit bola. Right? So even E is out. Answer is option A. Right? Great. Next one. In lines 23 to 27, the author lists several of the factors used to determine whether copyrighted material is protected by law, primarily to. So if you go to the passage, right? Copyright law outlines several factors. The use is protected, right? Kya use hai? Commercial hai? Ki non-profit hai? Nature kya hai? Length kya hai? Except kya hai? Ye sab the author has mentioned to give us an idea, right? About which factors play a role. So demonstrate why the copy shop owner was exempt from copyright law in this case. No, that came towards the end. Right? When the court ruled for the copy shop owner. Explain the charges the publishers brought against the copy shop owner. Maybe a little bit, right? The publisher ka charge ye tha ke hamara thoda nuksan ho gaya karke. Right? That was the main charge. So these other factors don't help in that charge. So even B also is not looking that good, but let's keep it. Illustrate a major flaw in the publisher's reasoning. Not at all. Defend the right to use copyrighted materials for educational purposes. Yes, that is, it can be used for that. Okay, it is not commercial, it's for non-profit, right? Provide the legal context for the arguments. So between B, D and E, guys, factors when they are outlined, they give the full context of the case. And hence, E is best. Answer is option E. Yeah. The copy shop owner, as described in the passage, would most likely agree with which one of the following statements. So copy shop owner bolta hai ki, I am just taking copies. The content does not matter. What money I am charging does not depend on the content itself. Right? The potential market value of a copyrighted work should be calculated to include the impact on sales due to the use of the work in post packs. No. अगर ऐसा सब करेंगे तो पब्लिशर्स डेफिनेटली बड़ा कोर्स बड़ा एक केस ठोकेंगे, राइट? Publishers are always opposed to the preparation. No, they are not always opposed. Publishers are saying if you ask for permission, then we are okay. We can, you know, give us fees and we are okay. So always is extreme, it is wrong. More copy shops would slightly seek permissions if the process was not so cumbersome. So that's why the copy shop is saying it now cumbersome or expensive hai that we cannot obtain permission. So C is looking good, right? Certain provisions of copyright law need to be rewritten to apply to all possible situations. No, the copy shop owner does not care about the law. Copy shops make more of a profit? Not at all. But they have the same profit we make. So answer here is option C. The information in the passage provides the most support for which one of the following statements about copyright. Right, तो ये जो केस हुआ where the copy shop owner actually won, right, tells us के new things can keep happening. Copyright law can be one of the most complex areas. No, it is just one of the small laws. There are so many more complicated things. Courts have been inconsistent. एक ही court का एक ही case का बात हुआ है. कोई comparisons of consistency, inconsistency not done. The number of the kinds of materials granted protection is steadily decreasing. Not at all. कि कौन सा material है, क्या है, ये सब not mentioned. New practices can compel the courts to reframe how it is applied. जैसे यहाँ पे reframe होके apply हो, so this is good. Copyright law is primarily concerned with making published materials. No, it is not primarily concerned with that. It is primarily concerned with ensuring that nobody exploits copyrighted material. So यहाँ पे best is option D. Fifth, which one of the following describes a role similar to that of professors in the passage who use copy shops to produce course packs? So what do the professor do? Un log bol dete hai ki tum ye read kar lo. They give readings. So ye copy shop wala gaan banda wo readings ka xerox karke student ko bechta hai. So the professor is just guiding. Okay. So an artisan generates a legible copy of an old headstone engraving by using charcoal or newsprint and frames and sells high quality copies of it at a crafts market. So artisan khud generate kar raha hai, khud bech raha hai. Yahan pe wo professor khud kuch nahi bech raha hai, so this is out. A choir director tapes a selection of another well-known choir's best pieces and sends it to a recording studio to be reproduced. Haan, to choir director bolta hai ki ye achha hai. और रिकॉर्डिंग स्टूडियो फिर रिप्रोड्यूस करता है, सो दिस इज लुकिंग वेरी गुड. अ ग्रोसर मेक्स सेवरल काइंड ऑफ सैंडविचेस दैट सेल फॉर लेस. तो अगेन यहाँ पे एक ही बंदा बना रहा है और वो ही प्रॉफिट कर रहा है, सो सी इज आउट. अ प्रोफेशनल ग्राफिक आर्टिस्ट प्रिंट्स रिप्रोडक्शंस. तो अगेन ओनली वन पर्सन वर्किंग, सो डी इज ऑल्सो आउट. अ सुवनी स्टोर सेल्स मिनिएचर ब्रॉन्ज रेंडिशंस ऑफ अ फेमस ब्रॉन्ज स्कल्पचर. Again, वो स्टोर ही खुद बना के बेच रहा है. Somebody else has to make or show, and somebody else profits. That is only happening in option B. That is your right answer. Which one would have strengthened the publisher's position, saying कि हमारा loss हो रहा है और इसका profit ज्यादा हो रहा है, right? Course packs for courses that usually have large enrollments had produced a larger profit for the copy shop owner. But again, वो content का profit नहीं है, copies का profit है, but let's keep it now. Had actively solicited professor's orders for course packs. ऐसा कुछ नहीं है. Whether the active solicit हुआ है या professor ने खुद बोला है, no difference. The revenue generated by the copy shop sale has risen significantly. Perhaps, but it's just based on number of copies. Many area bookstores had reported a marked decrease because of course packs. मतलब कि आपका loss हो रहा है. Loss हो रहा है, so between A and D, the loss of the publisher will play a larger role than the profit of the copy shop owner. So D is better. Publishers had enlisted the support of the authors to verify their claims. Not at all. Best is option B. Right? Great. Let's look at the next passage. County Cullen was one of the most, so ye pura naam diya hai, and birth and death, was one of the foremost poets of the Harlem Renaissance. The movement of African American writers, musicians and artists centered in the Harlem section of New York City during the 1920s. So Harlem Renaissance ka matlab ye pura that has been given. Beginning with his university years, Cullen strove to establish himself as an author of romantic poetry on abstract universal topics such as love and death. So, jab wo university mein shuru mein tha, so he started as an author of romantic poetry where he's talking about love and death, right? Believing poetry should consist of lofty thoughts beautifully expressed. That is what his belief was. Cullen preferred controlled poetic forms. He used European forms such as sonnets and devices such as quatrains, couplets and conventional rhyme, and he frequently employed classical allusions and Christian religious imagery, which were most likely the product both of his university education and of his upbringing as the adopted son of a Methodist Episcopal reverend. Okay, so he used these European types of poems, and he had a lot of classical Greek or mythology ko he alluded to them, that means he mentioned them. He used Christian religious imagery, he used all of these in his poems. Some literary critics have praised Cullen's skill at writing European style verse, finding, for example, in the Ballet of the Brown Girl, an artful use of diction and a rhythm and sonority that allows him to capture the atmosphere typical of the English ballet form of past centuries. So literary critics have praised his European style verse, right? In the Ballet of the Brown Girl, he has used a rhythm and a sound systems, right, that allows him to capture the same atmosphere jo English mein hota tha, ballet mein, British ballet mein. Others have found Cullen's use of European verse and forms and techniques unsuited to treating political or racial themes. So European themes will not work for racial themes, such as the themes in Uncle Jim, in which a young man is told by his uncle of the different experiences of African Americans and whites in United States society, or incident which relates the experience of an 8-year-old child who hears a racial slur. One such critic has complained that Cullen's persona, as expressed in his works, sometimes seems to vacillate between aesthete and spokesperson for royal issues. So sometimes it was on beauty and sometimes it was on race. So wo ek clear uska ye nahi hai, wo idhar udhar vacillate hona matlab you move from here to there. But Cullen himself rejected this dichotomy, this two breakup, right? Maintaining that his interest in romantic poetry was compatible with his concern over racial issues. He drew a distinction between poetry of solely political intent and his own work, which he believed his identity as an African American is a big part of his work. As the heartfelt expression of his personality, accomplished by means of careful attention to his chosen craft, his work could not help but do so. Explicit references to racial matters do in fact decline in his later work. But not because he felt any less passionately about these matters. Rather, Cullen increasingly focused on the religious dimension of his poetry. So instead of politics and race, he focused on religious, right? So in his Black Christ, in which the poet imagines the death and resurrection of a rural African American and heritage, which expresses the tension between the poet's identification with Christian traditions and his desire to stay close to his African heritage, Cullen's thoughts on race were subsumed within what he conceived of as broader and more urgent questions about the suffering and redemption of the soul. Okay, so in the Black Christ, he tries and imagines the death, right, of a black person and heritage wo tension batata hai ki I have Christian traditions but I'm also from African traditions, right? So his thoughts on race were a part, they were subsumed, matlab wo chota part ban gaye of a broader and more urgent questions about the suffering and redemption of the soul. Nonetheless, Cullen never abandoned his commitment to the importance of racial issues, reflecting on one occasion that he felt actuated by a strong sense of race consciousness that grows upon me, I find, as I grow older. So, wo kabhi bhi race ka nahi bhula, right? Great. Now, let's look at questions. Which one of the following most accurately states the main point of the passage? While much of Cullen's poetry deals with racial issues, he becomes less and increasingly in writing. True hai, par usme uska romance aur wo sab bataya nahi gaya. Jo shuru ka poems jo hai, they are not always racial. So this leaves that out. While Cullen used European verse forms and his later poets became increasingly addressed religious themes, his poetry never abandoned a concern for racial issues. Great, to race hamesha hai. Religious themes baad mein aaye, increasingly later on, and he used European verse forms. All these are definitely there. Though Cullen used European verse forms, he acknowledged that these forms were not well suited. He never acknowledged that. So C is out. Despite dealing with racial issues, Cullen's primary goal was to recreate. No, his primary goal was to just make good poems. If you see, yeah, right, it was in good language, beautifully expressed. That is his primary goal. The religious dimension throughout complemented the focus. No, it didn't complement. It became the larger dimension. Racial issues became the smaller dimension. So E also is wrong. The complement word is wrong. Best here is option B. 8. Given the information in this passage, which one of the most following exemplifies Cullen's conception of poetry? A sonnet written with careful attention to the conventions of the form. So, woh sonnet to likhta hi hai, sab jagah sonnet hai, right? To recreate the atmosphere of 16th century, no. Atmosphere is current atmosphere. So, with deliberate disregard for the conventions of the form to illustrate the perils. No, deliberate, though he is writing a sonnet and he's disregarding the conventions of the sonnet. No, he kept regarding the conventions of the sonnet. So, B is also out. The sonnet written to explore the aesthetic impact of radical innovations. No, no. He's not just going to write about diction, rhythm and sonority. He writes about romance in the beginning, then race and then religion. Written with great stylistic freedom. No, he sticks to the verse. So, ye bhi gaya hai, to express the emotional. Careful attention to the conventions of the form. Right. So, jaise first wala tha, ye bhi careful attentions hai. But yes, he did write about love and death. Aur isme death yahan pe aa gaya hai. So, E is best. Answer is option E. Right. Great. Which one of the following is not identified by the author of the passage as characteristic of Cullen's poetry? So, abstract universal subject matter hai, love and death, for example. These are abstract and universal. So, A to hai, characteristic. Rhyme, classical allusions, ye sab bhi hai. Traditional poetic forms, no, not at all. He does adopt the European verse, which is traditional. So, C is not mentioned. Sometimes deals explicitly, yes. Eventually, subsumed, yes. All these things are given. So, answer is option C. Right? The passage suggests which one of the following about Cullen's use of controlled poetic forms. So, he wanted to use it. It's very simple, right? Because he thought it will give beautiful poetic expression. Beginning, strove to establish, right? Should consist of lofty thoughts beautifully expressed. That is why he preferred controlled poetic forms. Because he believed they provided the best means. So A is looking very good. In natural religious themes naturally led him to use no, not because he was into religion. What happened? That happened later. Only the most controlled poetic forms to address no. Aisa kuch nahi hai ki race ko address karne ke liye I need to be in controlled poetic forms. Had rejected, he was exposed to prior. Ye kuch bhi nahi aisa bola hai. are better suited to poetry that addresses what is suited to which type of poetry not mentioned. So best here is option A. 11. The references to specific poems in the second paragraph are most likely intended to. To give examples, no? Ke dekho ye brown girl ka jo ek tha, ballet of the brown girl, right? How it uses rhythm and sonority. In Uncle Jim case, maybe. Correct? Again, both of these are examples. All these poems that are mentioned, they are all examples. Contrast some of Cullen's more successful poems with some of his less successful ones. No, nothing about success of a poem has been mentioned. Serve as illustrations. Right. So they are examples to the critics' claims. So B is looking good. Cullen's poetic persona vacillates from poem to poem. Not at all. His poetic persona, his subject matter vacillates from one to the other, but not his poetic personality. Summarize the scope of Cullen's treatment of racial issues in his poetry. Yeh, examples to, is not to summarize. Illustrate the themes Cullen used in expressing his concern. Not at all. It is just critic ke liye they are examples. So B is best. Right? Based on the passage that literary critics mentioned that would be most likely to hold, which one of the following views of Cullen's poetry? So Cullen's poetry can be used in so many ways, right? Itne sare examples diye gaye hain. So if you go and check, this is a romantic example. This is an example about race. This is also an example about race, right? Then you have these religion examples. All of these are in the same conventional poetic form. So it demonstrates, right, if you see the first option, that it can be successfully adapted to different contexts. It is most notable for the ways in which its content reflects upbringing and education. No, education ka kahan pe bhi reflection nahi aaya hai. It is more successful when it does not attempt. So success ka kuch baat hi nahi hua hai. Literary review hai. Its reliance on European is best suited to dealing. No, it is used for everything. Its focus is divided between aesthetic and racial concerns. Slightly, but it's also religious. And it can be adapted across. That's the point, right? So answer here is option A. Which one of the following most accurately describes the organization of the passage? So how is the organization? Basically, it starts by talking about how Cullen started writing in his university years, right? He kya likhta tha? So he wrote about love and death. He used European verse. And then later on, there was more race, more politics. And finally, there was more religion. So biographical is outlined. His artistic development is traced. His development, artistic development is not traced. Is outlined. Criticism of his use, no. Alag alag examples diya hai. Correct? So, and you also have actually the whole movement, right, of themes. So B is out. Is outlined. His approach to writing poetry is described, and the relationship between his poetry and his life, not at all. Is described. Approach to poetry is described. Certain poems are characterized as his most notable. No, some iska notability ka nahi hai. See, success is not mentioned anywhere. So D is gone. 2 is described. Differing opinions about the success of his poetry are presented, and thematic developments. Ye sab hai. So answer is option E. Correct? So critics ka differing opinions bhi hai. The themes are also there. Everything comes together, right? So great, guys. I hope you like the passages we did today and the VARC. Here is your bonus puzzle. You have to find the smallest number that is made up of each of the digits 1 through 9. So it's a 9-digit number and is divisible by 99. So if you check, right, 99 means it should be divisible by 9 and 11. So aapko 9 or 11 se divisible ek number chahiye. Correct? So please give this some thought And I'll see you again tomorrow evening at 6 o'clock, where we'll do DILR of CAT 2018 slot 1 paper, right? I can also see you on Unacademy, guys. So I have a special class tomorrow at 3 o'clock on Unacademy. So please land up there for the special class. You can see how great an environment we have, right? For studies and for CAT especially. You have live classes with the instructor where you have great, the whole environment is conducive to studying. You also have some, we are running a lot of test series right now for NMAT, SNAP, right? So not just for CAT, your preparation for any management entrance test is taken care of by Unacademy, right? And we have every fourth lecture as a doubt clearing session. So all these things, you will not find it anywhere else, guys. So please go ahead and subscribe. If you are focused on CAT 20, then you can look at the 6-month or 12-month subscription. If you are confused between CAT 20 or 21, then you can look at the 2-year subscription, right? Please use my code, Munira.